we influence how Africa sees itself.
We influence how Africa sees itself.
Thinks.
And ultimately acts.
Taking complex development issues
based on sound research
and unpacking them for ordinary Africans the world over. Changing tomorrow.
History. So these are the things that I love about Africa. I believe there is no greater continent than the continent of Africa. I am a Pan-Africanist to the core.
Africa, beautiful Africa. Orange sunsets, magical rivers, culturally rich, vibrant and exciting. Massive natural and human resources, untapped potential. This century has been predicted to belong to Africa, a time for Africa to grow in leaps and bounds. However, there is a scourge that is affecting Africa's competitiveness, sustainability, and development, which is of great concern to many, including myself and Femi Kuti. This scourge is bigger than corruption and is the secret behind Africa's resource drainage. Hi everybody, I'm Judith Sephuma. I will be taking you on a journey about our dear continent, Africa, and some of the critical issues facing our long-term sustainability and development. Africa is rich in its natural resources, such as oil, diamonds, gold, platinum, tourism, agricultural products and goods from industrial operations. Africa should be completely self-sufficient, but it is not. In this film, my fellow artist Femi Kuti and I, with the assistance of our many commentators and experts on the subject, will examine what's going on. And we invite you to acquaint yourself with this problem and formulate your own opinion. You may be shocked at what you are about to learn. We will take a secret peep inside the boardroom of a large multinational company and see for ourselves the sneaky ways that directors may use to manipulate profit taking and avoid paying the government of the country they operate in the fair and suitable amount of tax due to the government. Listen carefully to the financial experts and you will be surprised at the cheating that goes on. But there are many ways that Africa is being silently robbed of their financial dues. We will show you how it works.
Oh, good day, everybody. My apologies for being late.
Not a problem.
I hope I haven't missed too much.
Please have tea.
Thank you. I did send some apologies earlier, Mr. Bond.
Okay.
Let me run through the figures again. I looked at the board pack on the plane coming out, and I see the company is doing really well. Congratulations to the executive team.
Thank you.
We seem to have turned the tide at last and are beginning to show some really good return on investment based on our original startup capital.
Well, that is an understatement from the financial, and we're looking at $350 million profit before tax.
Well, this is where I wanted to find out, what is our tax liability?
Well, we're looking at about $150 million in tax.
I thought we were supposed to have some tax incentives for setting up business for some of our work in the tax-free zones.
Well, if we look at all of those, we can drop it by about $30-35 million. But we're still looking at a tax liability of $120 million at the end of the day.
$120 million?
Yeah.
That is a lot of gravy.
I've spoken to headquarters in Europe, and all they want is more from us. Because they're expecting that the subsidiaries, of which we are one, we have to carry the cost of the expansion of the organization on a global level. Okay.
Something came to my mind. I think, why can't we just manipulate our figures to say that we make less profit?
I don't really understand. What do you mean?
Yeah, well, Mr. Timbert, look, I get it. I hear what the CFO is trying to say. In essence, he's trying to say that we need to get headquarters to set up companies in the countries where there's virtually no tax levied. And then once those are set up, we can obtain our goods and services from those companies. And they will over-invoice us for those goods and services. So let's say, for example, if we were to order a consignment of valves, which the price would be normally $1 million, they would over-invoice us at $10 million. Thereby, there would be the $9 million deficit there, the difference between the $1 million and the $10 million. And then that $9 million would be moved to head office or headquarters tax-free.
Yes. Isn't that illegal? Isn't that tax evasion? And you're gonna go to jail if they find out what we're doing.
Well, it's not really illegal. I mean, different companies are doing it all over the world. It's what we like to call simply cost-saving measures. Aren't I a clever genius?
Absolutely, Mr. Bond. And let me also just tell you that there'll be a decent bonus attached to your package.
Thank you, sir.
This fiscal year. Okay. You. And I think by putting this on, ladies and gentlemen, we all deserve a bonus, don't we?
I agree, Mr. Shakes. We can give money to the HIV initiatives, and there are plenty of orphanages where we can give money, and then we can use the children to have pictures on our glossy annual report.
Perfect. Cool.
Are you feeling a lot happier now, Ms. Denver?
Oh, come on.
The scene you have just watched is not a fairy tale. This is just one example of how Africa is losing billions of dollars annually in illicit financial flows. What you just saw in that boardroom is an illustration of how commercial tax evasion through trade mispricing by large multinationals has bled Africa of its financial resources. Can you imagine how many companies are involved in this type of practice? Many multinationals across Africa have been involved in this kind of practice for years, mainly referred to as capital flight. Only recently has the term illicit financial flows been introduced. This is a term which most people in Africa have little understanding or knowledge of, yet it affects them. The issue of illicit financial flows out of Africa makes my heart bleed. This is an issue that is draining Africa of its lifeblood. It is seldom spoken about. It is a subject that is mostly unknown to the man in the street in any African country. It is hardly ever discussed in the news. One hears plenty about poverty, corruption, war, and political instability on the African continent, but the subject of illicit financial flows seems to hide under the radar. This film has been shot across more than 20 African countries, seeking to explain the phenomenon of illicit financial flows and the devastating effects such practices have on African governments, who are then unable to provide their people with all the infrastructure, services, and improved lifestyle they deserve.
What are illicit financial flows? And could you expatiate on this, please?
Illicit flows, the movement of money illicitly out of Africa through corrupt means, through smuggling and through trade mispricing, has been identified by many others besides ourselves as potentially one of the biggest causes to Africa's stagnation and also as a threat to the optimism that we see across Africa with regards to economic growth.
We're talking about a phenomenon that affects billions of people around the world. The phenomenon of illicit money flowing out of the poorer countries into the richer countries. The inequality that this causes around the world and strains in the democratic capitalist system.
Companies, especially multinational enterprises, have innovated a couple of ways in which they completely minimize any payments that they should make to governments of countries in which they operate by using a whole range of means so that in the end it gets to trade and make profit from a country but does not give back the minimum that it should, that would be used for development of the country.
From the accounts of the experts, it appears that commercial tax evasion, mainly through trade mispricing and transfer pricing by large multinational corporations, are by far the largest component, 60 to 65% of illicit financial flows. The illicit or illegal movement of money out of Africa has robbed Africa for centuries of its wealth, resources, and development capacity, leaving Africa plundered and in a state of poverty and underdevelopment, a third world as referred to by some.
So there is no proportional ratio, if you like, between what these multinational companies take out of Africa and what remains in Africa, and that is a major concern for AU Advisory Board on Corruption.
Now, according to research, the massive scale of illicit financial flows is perhaps costing the continent something like $50 billion annually. This is a lot of money that could have been otherwise have been used on the continent to support the actualization of development goals.
Companies that operate in Africa are supposed to be good corporate citizens and be seriously supportive of our development priorities. Companies should not be draining this continent of its resources through questionable practices such as trade mispricing. Let us see what trade mispricing and transfer pricing actually mean and their effect on economies in Africa.
A lot of people think that that this entire phenomenon stems from the developing countries. In fact, the system that facilitates the movement of illicit money was created by the Western countries. It was not created by people who live in the poorer countries. It was created by people who live in the richer countries into which the money arrives. Techniques. And then the most frequently utilized part of this structure is the mispricing of trade. Usually the overpricing of imports and the underpricing of exports for the purpose of shifting money out of the developing world. This is a well-functioning system that does exactly what it is supposed to do, shift money out of the poorer countries into the richer countries.
Transfer pricing is a tool that multinational corporations use to evade tax, right? They increase the cost of doing business to make it look like they're not making profit. So you can't charge tax over profit that's not there. But in actual sense, they are making profit, but they're just increasing, inflating the cost of doing business.
So transfer pricing often comes under the tax avoidance debates, especially abusive transfer pricing. So tax avoidance is really trying to move on that fine line between what is legal and illegal, and often it's deliberately choosing to interpret the law in a way that the parliament has not intended for it to be interpreted.
Wait a moment. I'm hearing tax evasion and tax avoidance. What is the difference between the two? I am going to ask my friends at Blandford Consulting to explain this to us.
Well, Judith, I get you loud and clear. You see, there's a fine line in terms of what constitutes tax avoidance on the one hand and tax evasion on the other hand. Well, in short, tax avoidance is the minimization of tax liability by an individual or company through legal means. On the other hand, tax evasion, however, is the illegitimate non-payment of tax Now, it's important to understand that the operational element here is the legality of the action of the individual or company, while tax avoidance is absolutely legal. Tax evasion is definitely illegal.
Judith, please do not assume that it is only multinational corporations that are guilty of doing this. Everyone, local companies, individuals, everyone is capable of evading tax. Trade mispricing is not just done by multinational corporations. It can be done by companies of any size that exports and imports goods. And I think it is important to understand that while multinational corporations will probably play a significant role because of the large percentage of trade that is done by multinational corporations, all companies of any size need to be monitored on the docks when they export and import goods, so that it is clear to customs officials that the correct prices are put on these products, so that money isn't siphoned out of the economy illicitly.
Are African governments sleeping? How can they allow companies to evade tax like this and perpetrate illicit financial flows? I am absolutely astounded by the scale of illicit financial flows out of Africa through tax evasion.
Not yesterday, him talk, him want to travel for the world, to teach the people him word, the true word of God. Make people stop to lie, saying a lie spoil the world. If people stop to lie, enjoyment go fool the world. If people stop to lie, if we 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 stop to lie. Stop to lie. If we stop to lie, 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 lie.
One of the loose ends which Femi Kuti could not reconcile in his mind is that this scale of commercial tax evasion would not be possible without the help of tax havens. And why are these secrecy jurisdictions allowed to thrive, and by whom?
What are tax havens? Do we know about them? Are there enough information about tax havens? Where are they? And are they avenues for colonial structures to extort money from Africa?
Well, tax havens are countries that have legislation, and so it's legal in those countries where you can actually do business and either not pay tax or pay very little tax. Examples could be places like Monaco, for instance, Dubai to a certain extent, Switzerland in the way they manage some of their banking transactions.
A shell company or a disguised company is a company where no one knows who are the real owners of the business. Perhaps the company formation agent knows, but there is no public record of who owns that entity.
If you can't put a name behind a company, you're probably doing something you shouldn't be doing.
We see companies coming to us. It may be a South African company, it may be a Nigerian or a Ghanaian company. And we know we're talking to Ghanaians or talking to Nigerians or talking to South Africans. But then when the time comes to say, who are we going to be advancing the money to, or who is our partner at the end of the day, you find that it's a company that is registered in the Cayman Islands, a company that's registered in one of the tax havens. And then you start asking yourself questions, why are you registered there? And the typical answer, of course, that you'll get from anybody, why am I registered in a tax haven? It's a private company. I need to maximize my profits. And one way of maximizing profits is to reduce the taxes.
So you can establish quite easily a shell company in a tax haven in which only the person who established it knows that you did so, but you can do business all over the world through that corporation and nobody knows that they're doing business with you. It's one of the major problems that law enforcement agents run into when they're trying to track drug dealers or arms traffickers or indeed terrorist financiers. You run into a roadblock. You run into a point where you identify the company, but you cannot identify anything further about that entity.
So if you're going to money launder, if you're going to move around the proceeds of crime, including the proceeds of corruption, you need two things. You need a bank that's willing to take your money, and you need some way of disguising who you are, what you're doing. And often what we find is that that's using shell companies, anonymous companies, where you create very complicated financial and company structures to hide who you really are. But it's really, really important that if you want to money launder, if you're a corrupt politician, that you can access the financial system. You know, you want to spend money in London or New York or Milan, you need to have access to banks in Italy, the UK, the United States.
And so it's that symbiotic relationship between the shell company on the one hand and the tax haven on the other.
When you look at tax holidays, the question that I always ask is, how many companies have you seen that have gone on to continue investing in the country after that initial 10 years? For me, that's the challenge that I have. There's so many individual companies that have come in to invest, and they've been attracted looking at by the incentive of not of the obligation not to pay tax, and after 10 years they disinvest, they sell the company. There's so many examples. I remember when we were in Tanzania looking at the same thing and the impact on the economy. Companies like Celtel, Zain, Airtel, they kept changing names, but if you look at the number of years that they were operating in the country, it can be traced back supposedly to the number of years that they were given tax holidays. So for me, the issue that I have is, if you're really looking at developing your own country, why would you want to deny that tax element for the government? Because that's money that they can use to develop the infrastructure. Why are we assuming that that money is going to come from elsewhere? If companies don't have that obligation and they're not, but they yet they're generating a lot of income from the country, why would they not be keen to develop it further? Because that, for me, is the way you sustain an economy, by investing in the country where you're operating.
A basket definitely cannot hold water. Whenever water is poured into a basket, it leaks, it continues to leak. It continues to soak, getting out of the basket. And as it is at the moment, you might look at Africa as a continent where corruption, illicit financial flows, and many other things also, is, you know, leaking through the basket of the continent.
Eish.
Conspiracy by who? The West against Africa? I don't know.
Okay now. Yesterday him talk, him want to travel for the world to teach the people. in a lie.
It's for the world if people stop to lie. Enjoyment go fool the world if people stop to lie. If we stop to lie, 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 lie, if we stop to lie, if we stop to lie, if we stop to lie.